الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله الأمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We're still discussing the ahadith that the author, may Allah have mercy on his soul, mentioned in the chapter that deals with az-zakat, which is the third pillar of Islam. And if you notice that usually jurors and scholars have this order of salat, which is the second pillar of Islam, and they mention it at the very beginning because it is the most important pillar after the shahada, and because it reoccurs five times a day. After that, they speak about az-zakat, due to the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal always mentions az-zakat alongside with the salat. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the zakat alongside with the prayer in the Quran. So it was suitable that they talk about it. Afterwards, they talk about fasting, because fasting happens once a year, and not everyone is obliged to fast. There are people who may fast, and there are people who are exempted from fasting. And then finally, they talk about pilgrimage, about Hajj, because it happens once in a lifetime. And again, not everyone is obliged to perform Hajj, as we will talk about this inshallah when we discuss the chapter that deals with Hajj. Hadith number 171. This hadith was narrated by Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him. He said that the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wassalam, a Muslim does not have to pay zakat on his horse or slave. And from this hadith, scholars said, as we've indicated before, that zakat is mandatory only in four categories. First category, gold and silver, and whatever takes its ruling, such as money and currency. The second category is the livestock, camels, cows, or sheep, or the likes of them. The third category is what comes out of crops from the ground, and we said that fruit and vegetables don't have zakat in them, only the things that can be weighed or measured by size and can be stored. So anything that cannot be stored, there is no zakat. Tomatoes, we cannot store it. It would decay and rot. That is why there is no zakat in it, or in the different kinds of fruit. And some scholars restricted that only to wheat, barley, dates, and raisin. They have restricted only those four categories. The fourth category is whatever is displayed for sale. So whatever is used to be sold and bought, whatever you deal in commerce with, then this has to be paid zakat for it. For example, a person who has a supermarket, then the groceries inside and the items displayed for sale, they have to be zakatable at the end of the year, after 1 year passes. Now the Prophet in this hadith, alayhi salatu wasalam, is telling us that you don't have to pay zakat for your slave nor your horse. And that is what the scholars understood from this hadith and from other evidences, that if you have something that you possess, you don't have to pay zakat for that. Why? As long as it is not part of the four categories. So your clothes, you don't have to pay zakat for them. Your car that you drive, there is no zakat for it. Your house that you live in, there's no zakat in it. The furniture, the utensils, the things that you use, no zakat in them at all. Why? Because they do not fall under the four categories, as we have discussed before. And the issue of dispute among scholars is regarding the gold or the jewelry that women wear. Those who said that there is no zakat in jewelry that women wear. Of course, when we say jewelry, we mean gold and silver, because women can have jewelry made of diamonds, of emeralds, of rubies, of different kinds of materials and metals. All of this has no zakat at all. The zakat is only disputed whether there is zakat or not if it's made of gold and silver. So it's an issue of dispute among scholars whether it is mandatory to pay zakat on such gold and silver possessed by women or not. Those who say there is no zakat use this hadith as an evidence, and they say that the Prophet said that you do not pay zakat over your horse nor your slave, meaning that the things that you use, we use our horses, we use our houses, we use our slaves, the things that we use, we do not pay zakat for those. So if a woman wears her jewelry, the gold and silver, or lends it to people to wear it and they return it, this means that it is used, and therefore there is no zakat in it. And this is the choice of the majority of scholars, that there is no zakat on gold or silver used by women. Other scholars said that no, they have to pay zakat for that. And their evidences are found in the Quran, in the Sunnah, and also in some of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, who said that there is zakat in jewelry. As for the Quran, the verse in Surah At-Tawbah, Allah Azza wa Jal warned those who keep gold and silver and do not spend it for the cause of Allah, that on the Day of Judgment, Allah Azza wa Jal would heat it, and then they will be scalded with it in their foreheads, in their sides, in their backs, etc. And there is another hadith where the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam saw a woman with a young girl that had two thick and big bracelets of gold. So the Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam, do you pay its zakat? And she said no. And the Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam, two bracelets of fire. And the woman took it off her daughter's hand and gave it to the Prophet as charity. Likewise, the hadith of Mother Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, when the Prophet saw her wearing some jewelry made of silver, the Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam, do you give its zakat? And she said no, but if Allah wishes I would. And then the Prophet told her that this is from fire, and also this indicated that there is zakat. And those who said that you must pay zakat for the jewelry or the gold that a woman wears are prominent scholars like Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, and before them, Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and ibn al-Qayyim. They all say that there is zakat in the gold or silver worn by a woman. Now, having said that, a lot of the times we're asked about who pays the zakat over the jewelry of the wife. Is it the husband or the wife? And of course, the answer is the owner of the jewelry. So who's the owner of the jewelry? It is definitely the woman. Who owns the jewelry and who has the right to sell it or to keep it? It's the wife. Unfortunately, I got a question a few days back, and the husband is complaining, and he says that I've been paying the zakat for the past 20 years, and the gold, I am the one who gave it to my wife. So who owns the gold? And I told him, did you lend it to her? You told her that this is for you to borrow, but I will take it back, or you gave it to her as a gift? He said, no, I gave it to her as a gift. And that's logically well known that she is the owner of the gold. Now, because you pay for the zakat, this doesn't mean that you bought it back again. The zakat is due on the wife, the owner. But if you, out of courtesy, out of your love and care and mercy, volunteered to pay for the zakat, this is acceptable. But you cannot pay the zakat without her consent. You cannot go and pay the zakat, and after a while, you come and say, listen, the zakat I paid a week ago, that was for your gold. No, because you have to act on her instruction and approval. So it is her gold and she has to pay the zakat. One may ask, what about if she does not have money to pay for the zakat? In this case, she is requested and instructed to sell parts of it, but not all of it, because it is part of a necessity for a woman to have gold, to have jewelry. This is what Allah Azza wa Jal described them by in the Quran. أَوَمَنْ يُنَشَّأُ فِي الْحِلْيَةِ Allah Azza wa Jal described them as growing up in their jewelry, in the way that they beautify themselves. So scholars say that they are not instructed to sell all of it, but if they have like 5 kilos of gold and they claim that they don't have cash to pay, and they're obliged to sell some part of it. We have a short break, stay tuned, and inshallah we'll be... Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. The following hadith is hadith number 172, also narrated by Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him. He said that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the harm caused by an animal has no requital, and the wound caused by falling in the well or in a mine has no requital for it, and there is 1/5 in the buried treasures. Now, in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us that there is no requital for what an animal does. And this is not our topic, but it is in the hadith, so we have to go through it briefly. What is meant by this? It is meant that this animal has no brains. So if it wandered and caused some damage, scholars differed whether they, the owner, should pay for that damage or not. And we know that if you made something harm that needs to pay compensation for it, that you must pay for it. So for example, if I make an accident and it's my mistake, I'm obliged to pay for the repair of the other person's car because I'm the one who did that. Likewise, if I break something, I have to pay for it. Now, when it comes to animals, scholars differed and they have a lot of discussion regarding this topic. Yet, the most authentic opinion is that if an animal wanders in the morning time, in the daytime, and he eats from a farm or he eats from crops, then this is not the owner's mistake. But if he does this at night time, then the owner has to pay for that. Why? They say that the habit and the nature of animals and herds to go and look for food in the morning, and in the daytime, it is the responsibility of the farm owner or the responsibility of anyone who has goods to take care of his goods. So if he doesn't and the animal comes and eats from it, it's his mistake. At night time, it's a different story. At night time, you're obliged to keep your animals in their barn, in their place, and the goods owner or the farm owner, he has to go and sleep. So he leaves his goods unattended on the account that there are no animals to come and harm it. Likewise, the Prophet says, if a man falls in a well or in a mine and is injured, the owner of the well or the mine is not responsible. And also scholars elaborated on this. And they said, if a person has a well in the way of the people and someone walks and falls in it and breaks a leg, who's responsible for that? It is the owner of the well. Why? Because he made it in the middle of the road and he did not take the precautions to protect people. But if I hire a man to dig a well. And this man is old enough, he's mature, he's a professional, and there is nothing to hide. I'm not cheating him. Or if I hire a group of people to go and dig a mine for me and extract gold or coal or whatever, and all the conditions are normal. And they go in, they do their job, and they die. They fall, break a bone or a leg, they die, the mine collapses. Is the owner of that mine or of that well obliged to pay for the compensation? The hadith states that he is not. There is no requital. Why? Because it is not his doing. I've hired someone to do something and that person died. Why should I pay for it? It's like when I hire a driver to drive my car and he makes an accident and dies. I should pay for his blood money? Definitely not. But if I cheated him, in the sense that I told him the mine is safe, there's nothing to fear. Everything is fine, everything is okay, and I know that it is not. I don't warn him and tell him that beware of this section or of that section. I don't give him the necessary precautions and I throw him, then I am responsible. If I get someone who is not mature enough, a child for example, and I have him work in such a dangerous place and something happens to him, I am responsible because this is something that I should have warned him or at least taken the necessary precautions. Then the Prophet says, alayhi salatu wasalam, in the hadith, and there is 1/5 in the buried treasure. If you recall, the zakat goes as minimum as 2.5% up to as high as 10%. You remember this regarding the gold, the silver, or the crops that come from the ground. We have not spoken about the livestock. Now, in this, the Prophet says, alayhi salatu wasalam, there is 1/5, and 1/5 is about 20%. So the scholars say that the treasure, you have to pay 20%. But what is a treasure? Scholars say treasure is not like what we think, that any money you dig out, the savings of people or something, that we call this treasure. The treasure has to have the markings of pre-Islamic era. If I find a marking that is recent, or if I find a box with rupees in it or with dollars in it, should I call this a treasure? No. This belongs to the owner. So do I know the owner? If I do know the owner, I have to return it to him. The owner of the money, not the owner of the location. If I don't know the owner, then it is to be treated as a luqatah. And what is the definition of a luqatah? Anything that you find on the ground, unattended, then you may take it and you have to advertise, you have to announce, you have to publicly tell people that I have found something of value. Of course, it would be quite smart not to say what you found, because then you immediately will find 1,000 people coming to claim it. You don't say, I found a watch of this maker, the color is so-and-so in that place, because immediately you'll find people coming to you. But the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, announce it, and you should know how it is tied and the color of the bag it was carried in, the description, because then I would say, I found an amount of money. Whoever lost it, come and call me. They call me and I say, okay, how much did you lose? The man says, no, how much did you find? I said, sorry, this doesn't work this way. Tell me how much you lost. He says, 5,000 rupees. Yes, this is true. Where were these rupees? He said, in a wallet, a green wallet. And the wallet I found was brown. I said, sorry, it's the wrong one. So you have to know the description so that whoever comes within a year claiming it, you have to give it to him. If no one comes, the money becomes mine. So the treasure we're talking about, it cannot be something that was recently or that belongs to a Muslim. It has to have the markings of the Roman Empire, for example, or something that goes pre the Islamic era. And whoever finds it has to give 20% of it to the treasury of the Muslim country, which is not similar to zakat. It is similar to al-fay, which we give the fifth to Allah and His Messenger and to the poor, etc., etc., etc. So scholars say that this is not zakat. This is considered as sort of treasure or booty that takes place without any fighting or with fighting. So whatever you have to give one-fifth of it to the treasury. And this means that you don't have to, you're not forced to pay the eight categories of zakat mentioned in chapter 9, verse 60. Also, scholars say that whoever finds it depends, because if I'm having someone working in my grounds, for example, in my land, and the one I'm paying him, the one I've hired, he's the one who found it. So who owns the treasure? The owner of the land or the man who found it? Scholars say, if I hired him to look for it, I am the owner. But if I hired him to dig a well and he found it in my land, he's the owner. So this is what scholars say in a nutshell, but it's important to know that it is not part of the zakat. It's a chance in a million maybe, or maybe in a 10 million, or maybe in 100 million that you find such a treasure. And likewise, if you hunt for treasures in islands or under the sea, it's all pre-Islamic, and that means that you can take it. A question that may rise in some of your heads is, what about oil that we find? Is oil considered to be a treasure? And the scholars say, no, it is not considered to be a treasure. It is natural resources and it belongs to the state to be spent in the welfare of their citizens. This treasure must not be paid in the eight categories. It should be paid in the welfare of the state, because we know that there are eight categories that you cannot give zakat except to them. But this treasure, you can spend it in building mosques, in building schools, in paving roads, etc. This is all the time we have. Until we meet next time, fi amanillah, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.